in to yet another edition of the Rare Groove Revolution. I'm your host, DJ Soulero. I have my special guest, Mr. John Carraro.
Peace.
Master record dealer slash collector. John, welcome to the show.
My privilege.
How you been? Everything cool?
Very.
What you been up to?
Like, waiting on you.
Oh,
waiting
yeah.
Yeah.
So just let the, you know, Rare Groove viewers know how long you've been a record dealer in general.
Let's see, 47 now, about 27 years, something
27
like that.
27 years.
But,
when did you start collecting records?
In my roots. So, you know, about my dad being a collector originally and then getting into the mail order business. And that just came about through meeting people and trading, and then it kind of turned into a little more of a hobby than, you know, turned into more of a business than
yeah,
just a hobby.
Yeah, yeah,
and,
yeah.
And it was a blessing, actually, because it brought in some extra money and much needed. And
that's cool, man.
You know, really gave me a foundation to work from. You know.
Now, you along with Alan Rouse Jr. were one of the premier record dealers at the legendary, now infamous, Roosevelt Hotel Record Conventions.
Yeah.
Now,
yeah.
How did you get into all of that?
Oh, I think Alan and I first met over a box of records in a flea market.
Okay. All right. All right.
Bumped heads over the same box. And from there, we used to meet on the weekends at the same flea market. And then I think I was already doing some shows around, you know, I told you there used to be a show in Hempstead at the Best Western, the Amityville show, which is still in existence, and some other shows around the island. But then the Roosevelt
mm-hmm.
was carefully planned by Dexter Campbell, which is you can read about in this month's Wax Poetics issue number 9, I believe it is.
Which you're featured in.
Right.
You wrote an article on the Roosevelt Hotel
right.
record convention.
But Dexter really put his mind to doing it the right way. And he went around and really collected, you know, spoke to who he thought were some of the better dealers. And,
yeah.
You know. It was more or less incognito. Nobody really knew it was coming,
yeah,
and
yeah.
The first show was a success, and from there it just grew. And,
okay. Now it's been said that you were mainly responsible for exposing the stark reality. Well, before we go into stark reality, I know for our intro music we had featured Hairstyles by Galt McDermott.
Yeah, well, it's
or is it
same songs.
Same song.
Basically from Hair.
Okay, okay, okay. By the Terminal Barbershop.
Terminal Barbershop. And
that was our intro music, by the way, y'all.
Years ago, you know, if you look at the album cover, it's not one that kind of catches your eye as being something funky or even
yeah.
rock and roll, you know, just. That's why I was a little surprised that you didn't know about it. You
yeah,
know?
Yeah,
but
yeah.
If you look on.
I'm learning
back,
as I go along.
The people that are on here, you know, Pat Rebelot. Charles McCracken, Joe mm-hmm. Farrell, Jimmy Owens, you know,
oh, Joe,
just
saxophonist Joe Farrell's on it.
Right, Sam Brown, the guitar player, Joe Farrell plays tenor.
Okay.
And it's just, you know, Aquarius, Hair, Walking in Space, Frank Mills.
Hair. Yeah.
Easy to Be Hard, Good Morning Sun, Starshine, and
what I call the Hair arsenal of songs.
Right, exactly, and it's just. It's really amazing how the variety of, well, first of all, musicians that have covered it, you know, the Hair musical. Actually, I saw the original Hair musical. My mother took me to see it at the Biltmore Theater when I was 14.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, and it was a little above my head at the time, but it was, again, it was good groundwork for, you know, later on in life. And,
okay.
I said, oh, yeah, I saw that when I was a kid, you know?
Yeah, so, yeah. Now, it's been said that you were mainly responsible for exposing stark reality to a lot of record collectors. Stark reality, for all of you Rare Groove viewers who may not know, is the infamous record, which is on every record dealer's slash beatsmith's want list. And it's been said that you were primarily responsible for exposing that particular record to the public. Now, who put you onto this record? Or did you discover it on your own?
No, actually it was a labor of love and a favor to Q-Tip.
Q-Tip?
Was the first one to come over to my parents' house, where I was living at the time, still with my parents. And he really had no idea other than what it was, other than that Hoagy Carmichael had something to do with it. I had never heard of it, but I figured, well, if Hoagy Carmichael, if it's done by Hoagy Carmichael, then my dad's gonna know.
Yeah, I could see the sun, like the light glistening off of this record right here by The Stark Reality. This is considered a holy grail among holy grails when it comes to record digging and record collecting. And yeah, finish your story.
Yeah, well, Q-Tip just vaguely had an idea that it had something to do with Hoagy Carmichael, and that it might perhaps have something to do with a children's show, you know.
Yeah.
Canada's answer to Sesame Street, or maybe our American answer to
Sesame Street
was America's answer to Stark Reality. And
yeah.
You know, I remember asking my dad, "Dad, you know, Q-Tip says there's a Hoagy Carmichael album called Stark Reality," or, now he didn't even know the title. And my father was like, "I know everything Hoagy's ever done," and he had no idea, had never heard of it. And
so how did you
stumble? To give credit where credit is due, and that's to my good friend and one of the best collector, one of the best record dealers in the country, Don Pingree,
okay,
from New Hampshire. And I would call him from time to time with, you know, wants, and that was one of them. I said, "I don't know what it is, but it has something to do with Hoagy Carmichael," and so on and so forth. And within about a month, I got a call, and he said, "Yeah, I think I found what you were talking about." And I said, "Well, let me hear a little bit of it." And
we're going to hear a little bit of it right now.
30 seconds later, I said, "That's enough."
Shooting Stars.
that fell out.
Yeah, it's only in one channel. These speakers. Yes, and that was the Stark Realities Shooting Stars off the 1970 LP. The Stark Reality discovers Hoagy Carmichael's Music Shop.
And it's actually Ahmad Jamal's Productions, that's the label.
AJP.
Yeah, and we know of two other albums that were on, put out on AJP, and one was Call Us Malcolm, Busting Out the Ghetto, and the other was Julius Victor from The Nest.
That was a hot album.
Yeah.
You put me onto that one.
We'll listen to that another time.
Yeah, at another, definitely at another time. And it's so coincidental that Stone's Throw Records, not too long ago, reissued this particular LP.
Did a great job of reissuing.
Oh, great. Yeah, they definitely, did a great job in reissuing
it. Unfortunately,
they
left off five songs.
Yeah.
Which
one of them being the Old Prospector,
right,
which we'll hear right now.
Right.
The Old Prospector. Thank you. Yeah, and that was the old Prospector by Stark Reality. And yeah, folks, so I know another record, John, that you've been credited to exposing to the public happens to be a group that was signed to a Rare Earth Records. And
subsidiary of Motown.
Which was a subsidiary of Motown Records at the time. And the name of the actual group was